people in Marion to have live-in servants. I wanted to know if this was a very unusual situation or whether it was more common than I thought.
Can you advance that for me?
Yes.
Thank you.
So what I found were about 8,000 households in the 1910 Marion census. About 60 families had live-in servants. Okay, so a very small amount, less than 1%. I did not count anybody who might have had a day maid or somebody just coming in to clean their house or to help them serve an elegant dinner some night. I'm looking for people who are just living with these families. And we see some clusters, and I think they make sense with what we know about Marion, that East Church Street, that we always called Society Row, had the most with 11 families with live-in servants. The others kind of spread out between East Center Street, North Main Street, South State Street, Delaware Avenue, and then North Prospect, Mount Vernon, South Greenwood. So kind of goes with some of those big old houses that we know are still around. But it might surprise you, I know it did me, that there was a smattering kind of everywhere through town. And along the bottom there, I listed some of those other streets, which we might think of as being kind of more middle class, just regular folks type streets. Oak and Windsor, Mound Street, Walnut Street, West Center, Mark, Park, Lincoln, South Sefner, Edwards, Silver Street, Cherry Street, and in the area of Girard Avenue, Cleveland Avenue, Bradford, Lafayette. So, it was uncommon, but it wasn't like just about five families had it and that was it. All of the people who employed this outside help, all of them were women employees, mostly white, and one that was a black woman, all the rest white. Average age about 20 years old. One man was employed, in addition to a female, he was the gardener. But most of them are going to have a white woman. Most of the servants were born in Ohio. But what was interesting is some of these families who had at least one of the main homeowners, maybe they're from Germany or their parents were from Germany, they tended to employ a German girl. And the same with people who came from an Irish background, especially the woman in the household, she would look for an Irish girl. Which makes sense when you think about it. You say, well, nobody can clean as well as, you know, an Irish girl, you know, so they're going to look for somebody that they feel comfortable with. And we know the women of the household would have made these decisions and would have done the interviews. And John's going to talk to you about how Florence interviewed to fill her vacancies at her house. So this just gives you a little idea that, yeah, the upper echelon of Marion is going to have live-in help, but domestic help was also cheap enough that regular folks could also have live-in help too. That first decade of the 1900s was our largest in our country's history as far as immigrants coming into our country. Domestic help was cheap. So a lot of additional folks would have hired a day maid or a laborer or even a chauffeur because it was cheap. You didn't have to be super rich to do it. So with that being said, that kind of sets our context. I'm going to turn the program over to John.
Hello, everybody. Just a little bit of housekeeping stuff. If you've got any questions, feel free to ask during the program. I need to be perfectly lined up as well. If I start strafing left or right, please someone wave their hand and I'll know to go straight again, just like an airport. But basically, if there's any questions, feel free to ask throughout the program. I always feel bad for the people that sit there trying to wait till the very end to remember a question, and hopefully it's poignant still. Don't hesitate. I'm happy to answer. I was a teacher for a while. I know kids like to throw out questions in the middle of nowhere, and I'm prepared to do it with adults as well. So as Sherry said, our event is on the help. This thing's obnoxious. Oh, they are lying to us. Basically, with the help, we were discussing like Sherry brought up, that it's a standard in this time period. People are bringing in day maids. People are bringing in chauffeurs, housemaids. They are living in. They are helping people achieve a better lifestyle, especially the upper echelon. They have better things to do than take care of their own homes and upkeep. That's why they bring in the day laborers. Why are we worrying about the need of outside help for the Hardings? Now, this is, Sherry brought up that there's a number of outside help that's come in temporarily, long-term. Again, we're gonna focus on a few individuals today, but why was this an important thing for the Hardings? In some case, Florence's health is one. If she had her floating kidney ailment and various diseases and ailments, she wasn't physically able to be running around doing all the cleaning and lugging and all that, and not to mention a woman of her status and her lifestyle, she wouldn't be doing that anyway. But it's that workload, it's too much for someone of her build to be able to handle. And again, status, this is an upper middle class, near upper class family. It's not crazy for them to have some people in that household helping. And we also brought up about the influx of immigrants, it's cheap help. If you can afford it, why not do it? Why not have a better lifestyle and a better, it's a status thing. You almost look weird if you don't have the help around your house as well. And it just doesn't fit Florence's personality. Florence is not domesticated. She is not the housewife that's sitting there cooking and cleaning. Florence is a well ahead of her time. She's working at the Star. She is an equal partner to Warren's. This is not the woman that you're gonna have home making dinner, making sure that everything's looking pretty for when Warren walks through the door. That's not her. Now, she grew up as a member of the Kling family, wealthy family in Marion. So there's no strangers of having live-in maids and help there as well. Down the bottom left corner, there's a picture of her younger brother, Vitalis Kling. For those of you who are not aware, Vitalis caused quite the stir of marrying the daughter of their housemaid. He married Nona Junkin, which is a wonderful name. Nona caused a lot of problems for Vitalis. He actually got kicked out of the family, essentially. The older brother Clifford said, if you're going to marry this Catholic housemaid, you're not a part of this household anymore. So if you ever go up to the Marion Cemetery, look at the Kling marker up there, you'll see a blank slot aside of it. Is intended to have a space for Vitalis to be there too, but since he married the Catholic maid, it didn't go so well. And he's buried across the street in the Catholic cemetery. So again, no strangers to help within their family life. So we're gonna talk about a couple individuals. The first two that I would like to introduce ourselves to is Frank and Bernice Blacksten. That is Frank right there. You're going to notice that the Hardings did not have a good dental plan, apparently. Oh no, this is amazing dental care compared to what you will see later, I promise you. Frank and his wife Bernice play an intricate role in their help. I'm gonna warn you, I have no photos of Bernice. I have looked, and the closest I came is you can see a little bit of an index finger in a line that I believe is her. Bernice is an enigma, and you're gonna see as this is going on, Bernice really is, she's a confusing character, and maybe that's why she kind of weighed low. I mean, she's a female homekeeper. She's not an intricate person in this society, so she's not going to be as much of a focal point. But she plays an interesting role all the same. Try to get a little bit of a background on our friend Frank. Franklin Lee Blacksten, he's born February 22, 1885 in North Bloomfield, Ohio. His parents are John and Eugenia Blacksten. He is the youngest of three children. He has an older sister named Delphina and a brother named Charlie. Now, his father, John Blacksten, is a farmer, but he was a Civil War veteran and hero, spent a year and 8 months serving in the Union Army, and he was a part of the Siege of Atlanta, part of the Sherman's March of the Sea. Kennesaw Mountain, he was one of the members of the group protecting Nashville when we took over down, well, the North took over, tried to keep the Confederacy from taking back. And he possibly, I haven't been able to match it up, may have fought at Mission Ridge, which if he did, he would have been fighting alongside Amos Kling's brother, Henry Kling, who also passed away. So it's always a small world scenario. Now the question kind of turns up is, where is Frank's drive? The more I've researched, I kind of discovered Frank is kind of floating through life. Frank's not really sure what he's supposed to be doing with himself, and he finds himself a niche and he kind of runs with it for a while. He comes from a family of farmers. And I think that's not enough for him. He kind of keeps his roots in the farming, and out in North Bloomfield in the Blooming Grove area, this farm is wide as far as you can see. So I think it was an expectation that he was going to join that kind of lifestyle. He did attend school. I don't know how far. I've seen newspaper articles that said he went to college, but I have no proof of him going to college. Census didn't say he goes to college, and I don't think he did either, but I have a feeling that future newspaper articles saying this man's associating with Warren, they kind of want to fluff him up a little bit, that this is a man who's educated and he's hanging around with Warren as well. But what you're seeing there is the grave marker for Frank's father, John. That's over in Blooming Grove, not more than about 100 yards away from the Harding ancestors as well. So they're all real close to one another. Now, to kind of get a feel for Frank is an avid car lover. He actually attends early car shows in Cleveland in 1914, so you got to think this is the beginning of automobiles, and he's there trying to see the cutting edge, what's going on. He loves working on cars, and back then, if you owned a car, you need to learn how to work on them as well. You don't have the body shops. You don't have Jiffy Lube down the road. You took care of your own car, and that's where Frank really finds himself a niche. He's a hunter. I think that goes back to his farming days. You go out there in the country. But he has this drive, and it seems like he wants to kind of follow in his father's footsteps with the military. He does enlist in the Volunteer Company L in 1903, and he has a five-year enlistment in the Volunteers. And it's actually mentioned in the newspaper that he found a dead body up near Lake Erie. This is news that he was just taking off a little leave, and he was going on a walk around the pond, around Lake Erie, around Port Clinton. And he found a dead body that happened to be the nephew of General Speaks. So you got a little accommodation for finding the dead body. Now, General Speaks, I know he exists because he's in the newspapers. I know the name. And when you try to find a photo of, I need to try to figure out who the gentleman is. If you try to do a cold search online, I'll tell you, type in General Speaks and you'll find everything that tells you about a General Speaks about Iraq, a General Speaks about Europe. He exists, I know he does. And I believe he was one of the later generals taking on along the Mississippi after Ulysses S. Grant left. But I can't confirm that for sure. And eventually I had to draw the line somewhere and say, where are we going? Are we worried about General Speaks or are we worried about Frank? So I kind of had to go somewhere. Now, Frank is going to enlist in World War I. He's going to serve for less than a year, but he's going to be a part of the Motor Transport Corps. So he's going to be working on every car that's going in there, the trucks. He found his niche. This is his thing. He's going to work on all the military vehicles for World War I. He never goes overseas. He only serves stateside, working on the vehicles and getting them ready to go overseas. And this is when you start getting a sense of maybe more of his appearance. You can see you saw a photograph of him. Photos of Frank are a little scattered, but he's described as tall and stout and with gray eyes and black hair. So he's kind of got a kind of a strange description about him. And that's the first way I found him, is there's this tall, stout man, and until you eventually can find a photo. He does register for World War II draft at age 57, so he was ready to serve his country one more time. They did not draft him, oddly enough. But that's kind of he's found his niche, his cars. He's going to keep on working at this, but the war is over, so what do you do afterwards? And the garage scene isn't really out there yet. In the meantime, he meets Bernice May Moore, and he marries her on January 1st, 1907. And this is when he's going to start trying to figure out, where do I go next? What's going to be my career in life? But we got to talk a little bit about Bernice as well. Again, Bernice can't find a photo of her, so you get a picture of baloney instead, so enjoy that. There's a purpose behind it, I promise you. Bernice May Blacksten, was born in February 2nd, 1886 in Indiana. Her parents are George B. McClellan and Annie Moore. I'm sorry, so she was McClellan. I got that confused again. Basically, she is a larger family, four members, three daughters, one son. George McClellan He works at a mechanic shop as a chipper, and he was also a member of the Kleinmar Brothers clothing store. He was working back trying to work on machinery as well as some basic tailoring. George Moore ran into a little bit of problems on November 12, 1911. He passes away at 10 a.m. Turns out 5 weeks prior, they had some rancid bologna for dinner. Six people got sick, and one of them looks like it was Bernice, but he's the only one that didn't make it. After 5 weeks of suffering from food poisoning, he does pass away from ingesting rancid bologna, which is one hell of a way to go, if I do say so myself. Now, Bernice is a member of the WSJ Club. I am not quite sure what the abbreviation is. I know it's a women's social, I believe it's Women's Social Justice Club, but don't quote me on that. I was trying to find it, but I couldn't find the Marion specific branch. So we're in this kind of realm, at least. And it's basically a group of local women that get together, they enjoy their tea, they talk about how lovely their homes are, look at your items of dress. And let's talk about some light women issues. This is that time where you have the parlor talks. These aren't people that are running up to Niagara Falls to fight for women's voting. I'm sure they talked about it, but this is more of a casual social group. Now, Bernice, I think for this reason, I think she gets molded into this because of Florence. We're going to kind of see that there's a little bit of a friendship between the Blackstons and the Hardings. This is not a group that I think naturally Bernice would fit into. They're home renters. She's a domestic housekeeper. This is not the person that really mingles with the upper crust and talks about these issues. But Florence would take her under her wing as almost a friend and brings her along to those kind of settings as well. Now we need to introduce another individual, Laura LaVon Rice. Now Laura Rice is one of our temporary domestics at the Harding home. She's only there for about a year. And Laura's story, what helps us with her, she's not there long. She doesn't tell us, we don't know really what she does afterwards. She kind of lives an average life, but she gives us this great oral history of what it was like to work for the Hardings. She explains the interview process, how she got in there, what was she doing day to day. So we really get a feel of what was Frank doing, or Bernice, or Laura, or any of the other domestics that were working with him as well. So she's born in Hilliard, Ohio. Turns out she was born about 2 miles down the road from where I'm currently living, which I thought was kind of fun. Tried to find her house. It is now a strip mall. So unless she lived in the Little Caesars that's down off of Hilliard, Rome, probably not where she is currently. Her parents are Adam and Sarah Spring. She comes to Marion at age 17 in 1900, and she's married twice to William Lester and Oscar Rice, and she has a total of 5 children. Now, her marriage to William Lester seems to be pretty rocky. From the best as I can tell, it does seem that there was some abuse in the family. He's a Teamster, so he's a laborer himself. She tells stories to other domestics about how horrible it was, and the domestics say, I can't blame you for seeking your freedom from that marriage, and they understand why she would never want to marry again. So whatever William was with her, it was not a pleasant experience. But she does find, she finds Oscar Rice, who's a wonderful guy that she ends up spending the rest of her life with afterwards. So it kind of worked out in the end. But following her separation from William Lester, she is committed in 1910 to the State Hospital for the Insane in Columbus, Ohio. The reason this is important is during the interview process, she mentions that she wants to make sure she does not say a word about this to Florence, because she does think that might possibly hurt her chances of getting this job and be as a live-in maid in the home if she said that she was committed to the Ohio insane asylum. Why is she committed? Best as I can tell, it's probably a nervous breakdown, some depression, going through a rough marriage like that and finally getting out of it. It just seems like she just broke down completely. She also seems a little spacey. She does tell about that she gets very preoccupied with certain things. When she's walking over for an interview with the Harding, she actually almost gets hit by a train just walking across the tracks. So she's kind of all over the place. I think she's not a bad person. There's nothing wrong with her. I think she had a tough life at the beginning, and she's a little bit beaten up, but she's trying to make the best that she can. She does work for the LaMarche family in Marion. If those of you are not familiar, Charles and Clara LaMarche. Charles LaMarche started the American Malleable Iron Works, and they lived off of Windsor Street, so this is an upper echelon family in Marion. They paid very, very well. She enjoyed that kind of experience, but the LaMarche family is very different from the Hardings. The LaMarche pays well. They kind of have the domestics, eating with them at all meals. They're kind of a little bit more a part of the intricate parts of the family, where the Hardings kind of play both sides, and we'll talk about that a little bit. So let's introduce the idea of what it's like to work at 284 Mount Vernon Avenue. So we have to talk about the interview process. And again, Laura Rice tells us all sorts of stuff about what really goes on. So Florence or Warren, probably Warren, would put an advertisement out in the newspaper saying we need some sort of domestic help in the household. They'll invite applicants out to the porch. They will not be going inside of the house. And Florence will be handling all the applicants and the interview process. She will be selecting the workers. She will have many applicants coming for the same day. Laura Rice talks about when she showed up, there was another woman on the front porch interviewing. And it almost seems like the previous woman was holding on just a little bit too long. And Florence basically tells her, I need to see what this other person has to say, and politely trying to get her to leave. Well, Florence is going to ask all sorts of questions, and she's going to ask very personal questions. She wants to know about their family, their upbringing. I'm just kind of get a sense of who she is. See what, and that's a Harding trait. Warren and Florence are like that. They want to get to know the people they're working with. So this isn't surprising. But if you're going to invite them to basically live in your home with you and work there, you want to know a little bit more. So Laura is very concerned that she doesn't bring up her brief stint in the mental hospital. She says that really could be a detriment to her. And Florence also wants to know her past experiences. Where have you worked before? And she talks about how she worked with the LaMarche family. And if you worked for the LaMarches, you must have been pretty high up there. So that's a good ringing endorsement. And I think Florence kind of has a tug at the heartstrings a little bit that Laura is a single mother at this point. Her kids are staying with her own mother across town. And I think that she could see the hardworking mother, remembering when she was like raising Marshall on her own. And there's a connection. She can see that this is a person that she wants to take in. And she does hire her for the cooking and the cleaning in the home. The pay is decent, and she gets housing. She's living in the maid's room up on the second floor, but she does remark that the LaMarches paid better than the Hardings. So now we got to kind of figure out what else is going on. Where does Frank fit into this? Now we're going to have people living in the house at different times. Frank and Bernice are going to be living inside the house for a while. Bernice is going to be a housekeeper for a while. Frank's going to be the chauffeur, and it's going to be a little bit of a carousel who's living in that maid's room at different times. And you can kind of plug them in different ways. It gets a little tricky sometimes. But in the case of Frank, he's probably hired by the Hardings because of his connection with Blooming Grove and New Bloomington. Chances are someone says, hey, I know this guy that's can work on your cars. He's a good driver. He's strong as an ox and come over and work with you. So it wasn't that crazy to think that he'd be recommended and the Hardings would like him. You have a picture of him with Florence outside in their touring car. This is during the campaign in 1920. So he gets hired on to be the chauffeur and the mechanic for the Hardings. He's also doing basic manual labor, and he's in charge of making the grapefruit segments for breakfast. apparently he is very good at that. It kind of makes sense in a second. I promise you, it sounds like a weird job description with it, but it does make sense. Bernice, his wife, actually began working in the house next door. Frank's going to work in the Harding home for up to 2 years before Bernice joins him in the Harding home, in which there's a Sarah Connor was the name. Sarah Connor was another live-in maid briefly, and it does kind of look like once Sarah Connor left, Bernice moved into that position. She's the housekeeper. She's a cook. She's doing basic domestic stuff. Her cooking skills apparently weren't spectacular. They were okay, because everywhere else you look, you always hear Warren remarking how this person's a fantastic cook or a better cook. So I don't think Bernice was really doing great. But Bernice does suffer some form of illness requiring a surgery. To an extent, I think it may have been a hysterectomy. They didn't have any children at all, and it seems like it was enough of a surgery to take her out. And when Bernice has to take a step away because of her surgery, that's where Laura Rice comes in to take over her spot, and she moves in and Frank moves elsewhere. Now, during this time, there's a story out there, a rumor floating around that Bernice may have gotten really close to Dr. Charles Sawyer. I can't give you tons of proof on it, and by tons I mean none at all. Carl Anthony, author on Florence Harding, who has a delightful tendency of putting out folklore and saying oral history without any real substantial, had printed this and published it. And I've heard, seen a few other places, but supposedly they got really close. And it's not impossible to think that if she did have a major surgery, that she may have spent some time at the Sawyer Sanatorium recovering. And maybe that was a chance for her to get to know Doc Sawyer maybe a little bit too much. And at first I kind of sat there saying, well, that doesn't make sense. I'm sure it's not the case. But over the last like 3 days, I'm starting to see more of Bernice may have had some marital issues as well. So as we go on, you might see that it's not that crazy of a thought. And again, since I have no pictures of Bernice, you can enjoy a wonderful photo of Dr. Charles Sawyer. So let's talk a little bit about Laura Rice. So she's in there doing what Bernice had been doing before. She's cleaning, she's cooking. Warren describes her as one of the best girls that she had working there. This is a new experience for her. When she first gets hired, she's excited to take the job. She gets to ride in a car for the very first time. Frank drives her back to her mother's house to get all of her clothes and belongings to drive back. She'd never driven in a car before. So it's just this wow experience being with the Hardings. And it's interesting that she's living there in the house, and I don't know what kind of relationship she may have been having with Bernice, because she's kind of taken over for Bernice. But she says she spoke to Frank a lot, they got along fairly well, and they're working pretty close together. Laura will only be in the front of the house if she's cleaning. She is only allowed to go near the front door if Florence isn't home to answer the door. But otherwise, she's in the back of the house. She's not meant to be just roaming around unless she's got a purpose to be there. She also says that when she's living there, she takes the back steps in the very end of the house to go upstairs and down the hall. She's living there. She's seen, but she's not really supposed to be seen. It's one of those kind of scenarios. And she talked about that while she was living there. Every night she would read in her room quietly or work on clothing for her kids, because she had every Thursday afternoon off and every Sunday off. So she would use that opportunity to run and see her kids, or she was courting Oscar for a little while, so she'd have chances to see him as well. She says that she felt a bond with the Hardings immediately, that they were like an aunt and uncle to her, although she rarely spoke to Warren, she said. So must have been a distant uncle in that relationship. She says that most often she said hello to Warren in the mornings, and she would ask Warren if he would like to have dinner served at 6. That was their bulk of their conversation. At one point, they had a conversation about mineral water. She did make sure to mention that as well. But she had a very close relationship with Florence, and you can tell that Florence kind of treated her almost like a daughter. Florence got a chance to meet Oscar while they were dating, and Florence made sure to march right up to him and say, look him dead in the eye and say, if you and Laura get married, I want you to be good to her. She kind of took her as, you know, one of her own, and there was a close bond. But she also said that Florence wasn't afraid to show her temper when she got really ticked off. Apparently, at one point, they were talking about religion, that Laura went to a revival, and apparently Florence didn't quite agree with that revival that was going on at that time, and Laura decided that she better drop the subject quick to keep her job. Now, Laura was paid every Saturday, just like all the star employees, and she said that her wages were left on a plate at the head of the dinner table, and she thought that was fantastic. Every other employer she had almost had to remind them, hey, I need to get paid this week, but Warren never forgot. She was always paid. There was always an opportunity as well that the Hardings would be busy on Saturday evening, so there wouldn't be a need for a Saturday night dinner, and Florence would say, why don't you go home early once you're done to go spend time with your kids. She was trying to kind of keep the family together, even though they were separated by living in the home as well. As far as her cooking goes, which Warren loved her cooking apparently, and Florence, as best as I can tell, liked it as well. Every morning she would cook Warren a light breakfast. Warren would never come home for lunch unless she had fresh strawberries and raspberries, because apparently she made the best cakes, and he would come home at noon for her cakes. But otherwise, he never came back for lunch, which she was okay with. She said it was much easier for her when Warren didn't come home for lunch anyway. Now, when Bernice wasn't doing so well, it looked like Frank was handling breakfast in the mornings, and that's where he got his grapefruit skills going in practice. And even though Laura started up, he didn't drop that practice. Frank got there every morning and made sure to cut the grapefruit segments for him. So it was kind of a weird little thing when you find out. It almost seemed like it peeved her a little bit that Frank was always there cutting the grapefruit segments. It seemed like it was kind of in her way a little bit. Now, she would make a light lunch in the afternoon for Florence. Now, you got to think, she's a housekeeper, but her primary skills is the cooking. That's why she talks a lot about that. Florence, having her illnesses, would only eat a very light lunch around noon. Mostly, they said more often than not, it was French toast, something real light and sweet. Once in a while, Florence would only eat candied cherries. So it was a pretty easy day for her on those. They never cooked pork in the household. There may be a little bit with the Seventh-day Adventists in there. But they ate mostly lamb, chicken, steaks, and roast beef. But Florence and Warren could not stand her cooking of steaks. She did not cook them rare enough. So Florence would have to take over every time they had beef steaks. And like I said, Warren said she was one of the best girls, and it showed, you can see why Laura was very attuned to hear what was going on in the house. She had heard Warren talking about how he was really wanting cornbread and sweet milk, and Florence thought he was nuts. Who wants cornbread and sweet milk? Laura had heard and spent the afternoon making cornbread, making sure there's sweet milk in the house so Warren could have that for dinner. And it goes again, there's like that family bond, that uncle and aunt. She wanted to kind of give back. There was that close relationship. And then every night, there was dinner at 6 o'clock. Now, she did not eat with the Hardings at dinner. That was something very different with the Lamarches. She ate with them every single night. And she said that was fine. She understood because the Hardings always talked about business at 6 o'clock at night at the dinner table. And she talked about people visiting, the Klings, the Hardings, all these other people coming and going. So it's a social home. But she said once a week, Warren would have his friends over to smoke and play cards until 2 in the morning. And this is when it gets a little crazy. She says they may have drank. She's not sure. But there's always a full bottle of whiskey in the dining room sideboard. So she thinks they might have been drinking. And they may have been gambling, because one morning she found a nickel next to the card table. So it gets a little crazy here. Now, the next morning was when things got busy. Frank was in charge of pulling out the oriental rug and beating the hell out of it outside and trying to get the tobacco smoke out of it. And then she was in charge of cleaning up the room, but she was not allowed to use their sweeper. Florence did not trust her with the sweeper. And this isn't a high-powered vacuum cleaner. It's a little Bissell guy that you're just kind of running. But Florence apparently was very protective of that. And so only she was allowed to run the sweeper. Now, Florence is going to participate in some of the light cleaning, Laura says. That it's kind of like a three-man team, Frank, Laura, and a little bit of Florence. And they're doing their cleaning, but Frank was always in charge of washing all the windows. And then every morning, and that goes with that quote, but that front porch, my, how I hated that front porch. Every morning she had to go out, wipe the banisters, hose down the front porch, and scrub it every single morning. And she hated every minute of it. She also brought up, though, that Florence was a wonderful woman giving, that at one point Florence gave her a dress that she no longer really wanted, a stylish dress at that time, and also discussed how Florence would give her clothing to the church, various charities, and also send them off to Marshall, her son's wife. And she had said a nice phrase in her oral history, saying, I wonder how much credit the Lord gave for her, for he wants us to be generous givers and not give it grudgingly. He thought of her as kind of that charitable person. And like I said, you can see this admiration between the two. And then the last story with it, which I think was fantastic, is next door, for those of you who aren't aware, George Christian Jr. and his wife Stella lived next door. And for a while, Stella's father, who they called Dad Pharaoh, lived next door. And he loved cats, and would take in all the strays. One morning, there's a cat scratching at the back door, and Laura was going to feed it, and Florence told her, don't you dare feed that cat. Let Dad Pharaoh deal with it. So at one point, Laura sees Florence and Dad Pharaoh arguing on the side of the property about what's going on. They couldn't figure out why. Turns out Dad Pharaoh wanted these cats to be around to kill every bird around the area, and Florence loved all the birds. So the two of them had a big old fight about cats, birds, everything in between. And the purpose of this is Laura is seeing them acting like normal people. We're used to seeing Warren in the newspaper office, or he's into politics, and Florence is the first lady. They're just normal people yelling at their neighbors just like anybody else. And their help is seeing it as well. So we have to move on now. Warren is going to be elected to the Senate. They're going to move to Washington, D.C. There's their home on Wyoming Avenue, which is currently the Monacan Embassy. On the left, you'll see what it looked like back in the 20s. Modern day today, not much has changed. Looks very, very similar. Frank is going to go with them, so is Bernice. They are going to be, Frank's going to be the chauffeur. Bernice is going to find herself a job in the War Department as a clerk. She's actually going to be working for the Motor Transport Corps, so same group that Frank was a part of in the military. So they're tagging along too. But this is going to introduce us to our next more colorful character. This is Inez McWhorter. Like I said once again, dental insurance was not a part of working for the Hardings. Inez is a very interesting individual. I thought she was going to be the most complicated person of all these to find, and she actually ended up being a lot easier than I would have imagined. She's born September 16th, 1880 in Greensboro, Georgia. She is a first-generation freed African-American. Both of her parents are going to be former slaves. They are farmers and laborers. She is one of 10 children. She had a brother named Pink that is actually going to be arrested for attempted murder. The family, it seems like most of the family members, except for her and a baby sister, really didn't get out of that farm laborer or stereotypical Southern post-slavery mentality. They just never really got anywhere. But Inez, she went on. She did better. According to her words, she never tied up with no man. No, indeed. You'll see that she's in a bunch of newspapers, and they always quote her in the kind of the scattered English that you would expect the traditional Southerner to have. And I think that's one of those things they really wanted that newspaper just to see, look at this diverse group and what she's saying. She's related to Henry Lincoln Johnson, for those of you who don't know him. He is a leading Southern African-American politician of the day. He's going to be the recorder of deeds in Washington, D.C. He's also going to be a member of the electing delegation of Georgia for the 1920 convention for the presidency and the Republican Party. Warren is actually going to renominate him for the recorder of deeds, and he's going to be rejected by the Senate because the two white senators from Georgia refused to allow him to take a position like that once again. And most importantly, Inez is known as a culinary czarina. Her cooking is going to be what's really going to set her apart from others. She has a wonderful pedigree of where she's cooked before. She's worked between Atlanta, Georgia, and Washington, D.C. Her first job, the earliest job I could find, was in 1900 at age 26, and she's working for a lawyer named Vassar Woolley. But in between all that, she is working in Washington, D.C. for the Blair family. If anyone's familiar, the Blairs are a very, very powerful political family in Washington, D.C. Monty Blair was the Postmaster General with Abraham Lincoln and his cabinet, and Monty Blair's father kind of helped pull the Republican Party strings during those times. Monty Blair's the home for Woodbury Blair is up in the upper left corner of Washington, D.C. To the right is 2021 Massachusetts Avenue. She's working for Fred Miller, a retired naval officer, high up there in Washington, D.C. And then the bottom left, she works for Ulysses S. Grant's son, Ulysses S. Grant Jr. So she has a pedigree. She looks good. She's working for higher ups in Washington, D.C. So when Florence and Warren are looking for a cook, they thought Inez would be the right person to bring in. Now, Inez is there on the left. This is in the kitchen in Wyoming Avenue, the home we had looked at before. They did a mass overhaul in 2004. It was owned by a private couple, privately by a couple, and they did a update. They said they did not want to do a renovation because it looked too hideous inside, apparently. It was kept up to date from the 19 teens from when Warren was living there, and they said it's just too gauche, I guess, and they updated it. To the right, you'll see the modern-day kitchen, and that cabinetry and that sink is exactly where Inez is standing in that photograph there on the left. Now, Inez has a fondness for Warren. She keeps on referring to him as my man. Anytime she talks about my man, the senator, all this, she really feels a connection with him, and she tries her best to give him just home-style, loving family food, and Warren loves every bit of it. She feeds him black-eyed peas regularly for luck. Warren never ate them before, fell in love with them, and I think he also liked the story behind it with the luck as well a little bit. She made au gratin potatoes, which she said she mashed and milled until as smooth as velvet, and then she baked it with cheese. And then most importantly, she made waffles with cream-chipped beef gravy. The recipe that we use for the waffle breakfast, I am about 99.9% sure, is really Inez's. So we kind of get a taste of what Inez used to be doing for them in Wyoming Avenue. But her waffles, according to the Bryan, Texas Eagle, went down in history of Harding hospitality. Everybody, at one point or another, ate Inez's waffles. And she also made wonderful cornbread, which was the standard of Washington, D.C. at the time. And Inez is happy to talk about her cooking. If anyone asks her what you do differently, why is Warren loving it, she always says, for when you're studying cooking, it's more than just a notion. It's the flavoring, she always says, that really makes the difference. And you just get this sense that she just really loves what she does. And since I'm a chef, I can kind of relate to her passion with that. And you can kind of, I don't know, I get a better connection with her. Well, Warren's going to win the nomination for the presidency. We're jumping a little bit. So we have to return to Marion, Ohio. So Frank has to lug the luggage. So there he is, leaving Wyoming Avenue with the luggage to return us for the campaign. Now, Bernice is going to start disappearing again. Bernice, I know, is traveling with them. And Bernice is still an intricate part of the family. When the Hardings take vacations, Frank and Bernice go with them. They go to Daytona Beach with all the Marion enclave. They go with them. But Bernice kind of takes a back seat. I'm not even sure if Bernice comes back to Marion during the campaign for sure. But I know Frank's here. I know Inez is. And the newspapers start paying attention to who these people are. And they're two good individuals for the newspapers to almost exploit. Because Frank is that average Joe who just loves the Hardings. They're saying he has a college education and owns a prosperous little farm near Marion, which he didn't. But he sticks to the wheel because he likes the Harding. Frank doesn't like to lose any time while motoring, and speedometer often gets over 40 miles. It's crazy. And that new, the article, you can see you got a good picture of Doc Sawyer with Florence, and there's Frank tucked away in the back at the Harding home, which is kind of ironic. If his wife actually did have a relationship with Charles Sawyer, that picture gets a lot more awkward. But that article by the Kingsport Times continues to talk about how Frank drives with the Hardings. Now, the problem with when they were driving together, the Hardings and Frank, Florence and Frank always outvoted where Warren wanted to go. So however they were driving, Florence would say, this is where I wanted to go, and Frank would agree, because they always went along with Mrs. Harding. So Warren never got his way on it. But there was one time that the newspaper said that the only time Harding was ever arrested for speeding, he was only going 18 miles per hour when the limit was 15. And he got pulled over and got off with a $5 cost for his penalty. And that was this was outside of Delaware, Ohio, so it should have been down Route 23 heading down to Delaware. Harding never takes the Delaware Road now if he can get through another way. So Frank was a little bit of a lead foot. Frank loved, and this is him loving his cars. I think he souped them up, he played with them, let's see what we can do with what I was doing, and he would just floor it. And there was the one time he kind of reaped the problem with it. Now there's Inez. Inez is a loud, boisterous, for lack of better terms, colorful woman that the newspapers are loving this woman. She has always got a quote, she's always a big smile, people want to see her, and she is this stereotypical Southern African-American voter. Look how diverse Warren is. He's got this average Joe guy that wants to work for him. We've got Inez, and this is about as Southern as you can get, and look how much she loves Warren. But I love the quote because you can tell just her personality coming through. When she says, Lottie Childs, since the senator done got elected at Chicago, I ain't had a minute to call my own. Inez reiterated for the 10th time. So you can see that they're interviewing her and she's just constantly saying, just repeating it over and over again. And they'll photograph her in these little poses. This is outside the kitchen at the home. And that's actually the back door of what we're trying to recreate with Project 2020. You see her holding this raw chicken upside down and acting like she's going to cut it with her knife, which scares the living daylights out of me. Especially there's another picture when she's looking a little closer and the knife's actually going into the chicken. So how she did not take her fingers off her hand, I have no idea. Well, like I said, they love her, but she's also quoted at one point of saying that, this is the interesting, the newspapers coincidentally clean up her accent when they need her to. So one minute earlier, she's saying Lottie Childs and all that stuff. And then she says, and apparently perfectly quoted, he's a man of sense and a good man who will serve everybody right. So apparently she cleans it up very, very well when it helps politically. But they also use her as a way of introducing civil rights a little bit. That here she is cutting watermelon, again, a wonderful stereotype in the back of the back of the Marion home, off the back steps. Apparently she has no sense of sanitation whatsoever. But the newspaper has her, they quote her talking with Frank out front of the house. They bring in all these delegations of various groups. And when they bring in the African-American delegation, they say at one point, Inez comes next to Frank Blacksten and says, Frank, every time the white folks has a delegation, the sun shines bright. But every time the colored folks has a delegation, the devil comes with rain and clouds. Now, what I ask myself is, did the newspaper create this conversation? There's odds. But then you see Inez with how she's yelling and screaming. I can almost see her seeing the reporter and just inching over. Hey, Frank, you know the devil comes out. Oh, I can see her screaming it, just hoping that someone picks up on it. And I'm sure the newspapers loved it. They're watching what she's doing and saying. They always are. Now, this is kind of a fun picture. We got a visiting delegate group, and I'm not sure what group this is. Do you know, Sherry? Sorry? It's the Pittsburgh group. Now, they're all out there for a delegation to listen to one of Warren's speeches. You can see Warren up there on the porch next to the banner. Now, if you notice way up top in the window, that's Marshall's room right there. There's a silhouette. Pretty sure that's Inez. Now, again, Inez isn't shy. She's not afraid to poke her head out there. Plus, I don't think she ever thought at that very moment someone's going to take a photograph. Who would have thought that? But it also raises the question of where's Inez staying during the campaign? Now, Inez being the African-American, a lot of these boarding houses aren't going to take her in. They can bring a white person in that'll pay this or that. Maybe someone's doing a favor for Warren. They're not going to stick her on the other side of town with the other African-Americans. She's staying in the home. She's more than likely staying there. And I have a feeling she's staying in Marshall's room as well, one of the smallest rooms in the house. So something's going on outside, she pokes her head on out and she takes a look, and she has an everlasting moment in history that no one really notices that she's there. But again, she's a normal person. She's curious too, just like anybody else. Now, this kind of takes us up to election day. Now, we always hear the stories of Warren going golfing. It's his birthday. Where is he going? What's he doing? But Frank's also involved with this. Frank's driving him around town that day. He's driving him to the golf course, driving him back, drives him to the polling station. And Frank drives Warren, George Christian Jr., and goes back to Marion, back to the home to pick up Florence. I think he may have picked up Bernice too, but I cannot guarantee that. And they drive to the polling station. Now, the newspapers make sure to point out that on this occasion, Frank Blacksten, who drives the Hardings' auto just as fast as Mrs. Harding cares to, was as important as the senator himself and entered the structure along with his employers. Now, basically, Frank's just the average guy. He's just driving everyone around. He's still kind of getting used to this paparazzi following him. And you can see in this photo, Frank's all the way on the left. He looks dumbfounded. Everyone's looking at the cameras and smiling. And Frank's just kind of there. He's not sure what's going on. Now, this is just, must have been a spectacle. You think you're going to vote, you're doing your normal job, you're driving Warren, who you've known for years before he was a senator, before he's a presidential candidate, and you're just kind of watching this thing unfold. They get there, and all these people are saying, Warren, please go first, please vote first, and he says, no, I'm here. He gets 13th in line, and he's posing for the cameras. He's acting like he's a movie star. They're saying he's kind of mocking the experience a little bit, having fun with all the newspaper guys, and says, that's right, let's keep the scenario going good. You know you only vote for yourself for president once. And a woman in the group yells twice, hoping for a second term. But again, you can see they're all having fun, and then there's Frank. So Frank's trying to understand this whole experience. So it's a little known fact that of the 600 some odd voters in the precinct that day, Florence was voter number 303, Warren was 304, George Jr. was 305, and then there's Frank, number 306. But as we know, Warren did win the presidency, so we got to go to the White House now. So Frank has to carry the luggage again. Most of the pictures you see of Frank, he's working. And that's just kind of where we go. So what happens? Frank and Bernice go to Washington, D.C. with them. Once again, if Bernice ever left. They don't live in the White House. They are going to be boys at 1907 New Hampshire Avenue. That's a picture of it on the right today, what it looks like. So it's a tight-knit community, a standard homes of the day. And Frank is going to be one of five chauffeurs on staff. He has been, the newspapers are saying how he's going to be in charge of the motorcade of the White House. And he took his friend along. I mean, Warren's going to take his friends along. He knows Frank. He knows Bernice. Now, Bernice is still looking for work a little bit. And Warren actually kind of extends a little bit of generosity and passes the executive order number 3507. Bernice is trying to get a job over in with the civil service in the clerical position with classified civil service. She doesn't qualify. She did not pass the exams. She did not pass anything that they wanted with her. And Warren passed the executive order saying that it's okay, you can hire her anyway. So he got his former housemaid a job despite whether she really should have or not. Now, the question is, how often do they really see them? I mean, Warren's busy doing his presidential work, Florence is doing the same, but they did say that Frank gets around to the White House enough to be known favorably by Laddie Boy. So he must be around at least a little bit. And then we come to Inez. Again, Inez is this wonderful, quotable newspaper person that, I mean, it kind of speaks for itself. The Oakland Tribune says, it may be considered a peculiarly American that Inez McWhorter, the Harding cook, whose waffles fame precedes the administration and family to the White House, should be illustrated on the same page as the members of the cabinet. This is a full-page article that said, we have Albert Fall, we have Charles Evans Hughes, and we have Inez McWhorter. So it's just that another level. And in Washington, D.C., everyone knew Inez. Everyone knew her waffles. Everyone knew that the Hardings had this hospitality. They knew her and her personality. And they asked her, well, what's it going to be like to cook in the White House? Because they're all saying that Florence is going to take her. And she says, what? Afraid of that job? You just don't know me. I guess I could cook. I can't even speak like this either. I don't know how she did. I guess I could cook just as well down there in the big house for President and Mrs. Harding as I have filled the bill here for over a year for Senator and Mrs. Harding. So she's telling them, I'm not afraid to go cook in the White House. And they're fully staffed with cooks, and there's speculation of what's going to happen when they bring this woman into the White House. And this is the chefs there, they're white. You don't bring in this Southern black woman. It's very interesting. They're all speculation she's coming, but she never does. For whatever reason, she turned down the opportunity to cook in the White House and decides that she'd rather be an aide de cuisine, she calls herself. So she is working elsewhere, but she stops by the White House and drops off Warren's favorite foods. And I almost feel like it's almost spiteful that these chefs in the White House are cooking these wonderful food and look at this for these dinners. And then Inez comes with his favorite crumb pie and just kind of shoots it right back down again. I could just see her boisterously walking in, and here you go, and just seeing everyone just turning red in that kitchen. Now, there's a book published in 1923. It's the Mrs. Harding 20th Century Cookbook. Now, you go through it, there's a couple of recipes of Florence's, I'm sure, in there. But there's a number of recipes of Inez's in there, too. The way we can tell that is Inez isn't afraid to have some of her recipes out there, not all of them. And she allows some of them to be published in the newspapers, and you can find some of those recipes in that book, in particular her chicken and dumplings recipes in there. But the waffle recipe isn't the same. And I think she tried to keep that one secret to herself, because that's her bread and butter, for lack of better terms. But she's kind of keeping her influence in there. Now, Warren always said that she had a flavor all of her own, that he could distinctly tell Inez's cooking. And Harry Daugherty, the Attorney General, as the gentleman pictured up there on the right, threw a Christmas party one year and invited Inez to cook, but didn't tell Warren or any of the guests that Inez is cooking. Warren is eating and says to the group, this tastes like Inez's cooking. I haven't enjoyed a meal so much in a long time. And then the newspaper continues to say, with the dessert, the beaming face of Inez appeared at the pantry door, and the President and Mrs. Harding cried out with pleasure while they hurried to tell her that they had recognized her cooking. there's a connection with them. And Inez, again, boisterous person. I neglected to mention that when Warren first gets the nomination for the presidency, the newspapers say that when the train's coming back to town from Chicago, she is shoving through the crowd, pushing people aside to be up there to shake his hand immediately and go see my man one more time. There is definitely a connection between the two. We jump ahead again. August 2nd, 1923, a couple days ago, the anniversary, Warren passes away. So what happens to everybody? We need to figure that out. Inez continues cooking and working. And the last job, she's going to be between Washington, D.C. and Atlanta, Georgia. She's going to go back to Georgia. She does have some family down there. And her probably her very last job is going to be in the home of Robert F. Shepard. That's his home on the left today. This is 1312 18th Street in Washington, D.C. These are very nice neighborhoods. This is over by DuPont Circle. It's over by all the areas where the embassies are. These are nice homes, so she's still getting good work. But she also is still being interviewed by newspapers, asking her certain thoughts. I have a feeling they tried to get to know anything with teapot domes and all that. Everyone was talking about that. But they said her two favorite things to talk about to anybody was cooking and President Harding. And she will actually visit the Harding Memorial Association headquarters in Washington, D.C. fairly often. She says that, as she told the newspapers, the Senator, I never seemed to could get used to him being president. She never knew him as the, she never thought of him as president. It was just the man she cooked for. And she, I don't even think she thought of him as the Senator. It was just Warren, the guy that she cared about and cooked for and wanted to be a part of. And she actually participated in fundraisers, cooking waffles with chipped beef gravy, just like we do every year now, to contribute to raise money for the memorial here in Marion. She continued to do that up until she passed away. She dies August 7th, 1932, with a very good estate of $33,000 at that time and just north of $500,000 today. She is buried behind the historic Springfield Baptist Church in Greensboro, Georgia, which is an interesting little place where it was one of the very first churches in the middle of Georgia that was entirely African American. It was established before slavery ended, and after the war, it integrated until the white congregation said, we don't want you here anymore, and booted them out, and gave them $200 to build that church. So it's kind of an interesting little thing, and Inez is a devout Baptist, so she goes back to the church. And it's because of this that actually helps us find Inez. Trying to find her history, we had to work backwards. And Inez's executor of her will was a Fanny McWhorter, who was her baby sister, a nurse, and was able to trace back the family that way to be able to find Inez at the very beginning. So sometimes you have to work at the end and go backwards in hopes to find the story as well. But that pretty much leaves Inez. And then we come to Frank and Bernice, which gets kind of a little interesting. Frank seems very restless. Warren's dead. He lost his point. He's not a chauffeur anymore. He started seeing the limelight. We saw him with the election being a part of this. He's not sure what to do. He's going to move from Columbus to Canton, back to Washington, D.C. He's going to be in Grant, Indiana. He's going to be an insurance claims adjuster. He's going to be a mechanic. He's going to be a car salesman. Bernice is going to pretty much be a housewife for the most part, but we start seeing some issues arise. That home there on the left was their home on 482 Alden Avenue. This is over by Columbus Crew Stadium down there, about two blocks away from the Ohio Historical Society, or Connection, or whatever they call it now. But in 1933, there's a reference in the city directory that Bernice is living by herself in the home. And I start to wonder, are they having problems in their relationship a little bit? Now, there always seems to be, I have a sense that there might be some bitterness with not having children, perhaps. Maybe Frank is so restless, not knowing what to do, and Bernice is sick of it. I'm not sure. And then the brain starts going, well, what if this Doc Sawyer affair thing is true? Maybe something's not right. There's a lot of angles. It's all theories. Depends on how you want to go. If you want to get really dirty, I'm sure everyone can go in different directions, but it starts raising questions a little bit. Frank takes a crack at being a used car salesman down there in Columbus. He opens Blacksten Auto Sales. We are overstocked on used cars and have over 40 real bargains for a quick sale on easy terms made with popular models and makes. Same kind of ad you would see today. Up there on that map, second from the left on the bottom there, the very bottom corner of it, that big square with the weird little white corner taken out of it, that would be his car lot. On the right, you'll see a modern day picture. Today is the Elevator Brew House of Columbus. So if you ever go downtown and have a nice dinner down there and a beer, you can know that you're probably sitting exactly where Frank was, hoping to sell a used car that day. They take one more crack to reestablish themselves, Frank and Bernice. They move down to the land, Florida, and they kind of go in really new, different directions. This is the 1950s. Bernice starts going by the name Bertha now. For some reason, this is her new persona. She's Bertha Blacksten. And Bertha now works at the Fish Memorial Hospital in Orange City. That's there on the left. And she's like a medical aide or probably similar to the Candy Striper. She's not doing anything major, but she's working over there. And Frank is working at the historic Putnam Hotel as a head hotel clerk. Very new directions, very different, and you can kind of sense, again, Frank doesn't know what to do with himself, and Bernice is kind of going along for the ride, and I kind of feel like Florida's that turning point. We're going to try something new. And then we lead to some more confusion. Frank's going to pass away on January 19th, 1962, in Orange City. He's buried in the DeLand Memorial Gardens, and he has a full military burial and marker. Bertha filled out the paperwork to get all the markers. You can find all that out there. Now, Bernice/Bertha ends up remarrying. Frank is still warm in the grave. And it gets a little weirder from there. Bernice marries Louis Drew. He's an insurance salesman in town. Louis's wife, Roberta, passed away in November 1961. Frank's dead January 1962. And now Frank, Bernice, and Louis are wed June of 1962. It didn't take too long for them to start again. And there's a substantial age difference. Bernice is 76, Louis is 43. That's a 37-year difference. And if I do use Ancestry for some sources of information, and you go through there, and there's family histories, and they have message boards. They don't seem too fond of Bertha in their family tree, and they don't really want to talk about Bertha. Everyone's worried about Roberta. Where's Roberta? And someone asks, well, who's this Bertha? And that comment comes up, we're not worried about Bertha. Who's Roberta? And they're going through there. I get the sense that this was not really something they were really proud of going on in that family. Now, Bernice/Bertha kind of disappears from there. Going by cemetery records, when people pass away, sometimes if you'll send some family history to the cemetery in case you don't have family members buried there to kind of continue information that people are trying to track down. And apparently Bernice sent information, or someone in the family sent information, and said that she went to Alabama. I can't find her in Alabama. I know she died somewhere in 76 or 77. Because she had to have survived her second husband, because we have the obituary up there that says he passed away in 75, and according to the obituary, Bertha's still alive. Now, where it gets a little sticky again is Frank is buried in a couple's grave. Frank is buried there, and next to him is a man named Marilyn Sills. Now, who's Marilyn Sills? That should be Bernice's grave. Well, in the records of people submitting to the cemetery, it says that this Marilyn Sills is the grandson of Bertha Blacksten and a William Sills, I'm sorry. So was there another man that we don't know about? This Marilyn Sills is born in 1938, within 5 years of where I think there might have been a little bit of a rocky patch. Now, the other thing that throws in there, if Bertha had a hysterectomy, then this makes no sense whatsoever. But maybe it didn't take. Or maybe it was an adoption. Maybe it's just something that's thrown out there. I don't know. But it just, the thing is, there's so many times that someone's saying Bernice is with some other guy, it really starts making you question. Maybe there was something with Dr. Sawyer. Maybe there wasn't. Louis Drew popped up pretty darn quick. You just don't know. And that's where I get a sense that there was a little issues between Frank and Bernice. And they're just normal people. They worked for Warren, but they're just normal people. So it just keeps on getting trickier and trickier. But essentially, that's as best as we can get of finding these people who are little players, but significant players in their lives. And I'd be happy to answer any questions if anyone's got any. Phew. Yeah. Thank you.
Where was that first house that just showed on the screen? The very first one.
The double green one.
With Bernice.
Oh, let me make sure I'm in the right one. That one? The bologna one. I don't know if I wrote that one down. I have it in my other notes, which are sitting at my desk at home, if you'd like to join me back in Hilliard later on for a cup of coffee. That's 242 South State Street. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's a beautiful home, and that's one thing that's fantastic about Harding history in this area. All these houses are still there. You can always find these places, and they just put up nicer siding at one point or another, but they're still there. Anything else I can answer for some? Yeah.
When you talked about Laura, you were telling things that she said.
Mm-hmm.
It
was an oral history done by her granddaughter, and we have excerpts of it. Laura did write it, though. But I thought the granddaughter helped transcribe it. She bounces around a little bit. She's a little bit, you can tell she's a little confused on years. And chances are, you get older in age, years aren't going to. Mm-hmm. So she kind of gets the years confused when Warren may have been lieutenant governor when she worked there, and you kind of piece it together. That the information's there, just a little bit of the timeline's a little shaky. Hmm? Yeah?
How did Inez die so wealthy?
I would assume it's because she worked for some very good family members. She always had housing and board. So if you think about that, even if they're not paying you substantially, you can always put that money aside. That's to the best of my guess. You also have some other scenarios. I know I have a distant relative that was a ladies' lady in New York City back in the 30s, or when was Tuntalata around? That's a fancy term when you have family members trying to pick different names for family members. Well, she worked for the ladies' lady. When she passed, the ladies' lady passed away, she left whatever great-aunt, great-great-aunt relation she would have been to me in her will and left her a substantial amount of money as well. So there's always possibilities of that coming along, too. That stuff can be very difficult to dig up, but that's my best guess because she died very wealthy, and it looked like Fanny got a little bit of the money, her younger sister, but it looks like also the local church got a lot of money, and I believe some got left to the Hardings as well. I'm still waiting for my return phone call from probate down there to get to see the will. I'm also waiting for phone calls from the genealogy department at DeLand, Florida, and the minister of the church down in Springsboro, and the youth minister. I got his cell phone number through Facebook. So if anyone calls me back, I'll certainly let people know, too. All right. Well, thank you very much. I do appreciate it. Thank you.
What a tremendous job you've done. And I'm going to tell you,